Circuit and Beldon Methodist Church. My name's Peter. Beldon Methodist Church is my home church, and together as church and circuit, we are glad that you can join us, and whoever you are and wherever you are most welcome. Today is the second Sunday in Lent, and we focus on the relationship between Jesus and his disciple Peter. And from this, we will think about our lives and how Jesus enables us to be open and honest without fear of rejection. So we begin with a collect. It's a word we've heard many times, week by week. But what is a collect? Well, it's a prayer that gathers our thoughts together, the thoughts that we might have that are relevant to a subject or a theme, and offers them to God. So let us pray together. Loving God, we come from our busy lives, and we often forget that in our busy lives you walk with us. As we share in worship, help us to be more aware of who you are. Give us courage to admit when we don't understand. Give us patience to listen to you. Help us to be open to learn more from you, so that we might grow to be more like you in all that we do. Amen. And we share together now in our first song, "Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His goodness lives forever." It's in Singing the Faith, number 77. Our first Bible reading comes from Mark's Gospel, chapter 8, and it's verses 31 to 38. Jesus is explaining what is going to happen to him and that he will be killed. At this, Peter protests and reacts, but Jesus says, "If anyone would come to me, they must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me." And Ross Crossland is going to read this passage for us.
Jesus predicts his death. He then began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests and the teachers of the law, and that he must be killed and after 3 days rise again. He spoke plainly about this, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But when Jesus turned and looked at his disciples, he rebuked Peter. "Get behind me, Satan," he said. "You do not have in mind the concerns of God, but merely human concerns." Then he called the crowd to him, along with the disciples, and said, "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it. But whoever loses their life for me and for the gospel will save it. What good is it for someone to gain the whole world yet forfeit their soul? Or what can anyone give in exchange for their soul? If anyone is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will be ashamed of them when he comes in his Father's glory with the holy angels."
There's a place where mercy reigns and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide, where all the love like a flood comes flowing down. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you, I'm in all of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe
hope is found here on holy ground. Here I bow down, here I bow down. Here, arms open wide, here you save my life. Here I bow. You see what?
Thanks, Ross, for sharing that reading with us and also for providing the pictures that followed it. Jesus says, if anyone is ashamed of me, could that be Peter? Never, not in Peter's mind anyway. But perhaps we shall see. So Peter, who was he? His birth name was Simon, and he lived in or around Bethsaida at the northern end of the Sea of Galilee. But he moved to Capernaum to be with Jesus. He was introduced to Jesus by his brother Andrew. In John chapter 1 and at verse 41, we read, the first thing that Andrew did was to find his brother Simon and to tell him, we have found the Messiah, that is the Christ. And he brought him to Jesus. Jesus was a fisherman, working with his brother Andrew and also with James and John, the sons of Zebedee. So let's think about Peter. What was he like? He was a big character. Peter was always noticeable, perhaps regarded as a leader. Those who saw him with a group of disciples would go to him for information, perhaps. In Mark 17, he records that after Jesus and his disciples arrived in Capernaum, the collectors of the 2 drachma temple tax came to Peter and asked, doesn't your teacher pay the temple tax? Yes, he does, answered Peter. Or again, in Matthew 18, verse 21, when Jesus uses a parable that is difficult to understand, it is Peter who is the first to ask for an explanation. But Peter is headstrong. He's full of good intentions, but doesn't always think things through. This comes across in several examples. when the disciples met with Jesus to celebrate the Passover. They were Jews, and the Passover is a very significant festival, celebrating their ancestors' release from slavery in Egypt. So this was a natural thing to do. And when they meet, Jesus as host greets them. But then he takes on the role of the servant and washes their feet. Again, a natural thing to occur, but it was the servant's job. And John in chapter 13 records Peter's astonishment and his refusal to let Peter do this. And Jesus says to Peter, "You don't understand why I'm doing this, but eventually you will." "No," says Peter, "you're never going to wash my feet." But Jesus tells Peter, if he won't have his feet washed, then there is no place with him. So Peter then wants to be washed all over, not just my feet, but my hands and my head also. Matthew again records that Jesus walks across the water to the disciples' boat. It's just before dawn, and they are all terrified. But Jesus immediately said to them, "Take courage, it is I, don't be afraid." "Lord, if it is you," Peter replied, "tell me to come to you on the water." "Come," he said, and Peter got down out of the boat and walked on the water and came towards Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid and, beginning to sink, cried out, "Lord, save me." And things are getting really tough for Jesus now. For our second reading, we hear an adaptation of Mark chapter 14, verses 66 to 72. We find Peter in the grounds of the high priest's palace. It was as far as he dared to go, trying to see what was happening to Jesus after he'd been arrested. He's trying to be unnoticed, but the pressure is really on. Now, thanks go to Ian and Jill Dobson from Thackley, and thanks to writer Marjorie Dobson and to Stainer and Bell for allowing us to use this piece. I wondered about the setting for this reading. Should it be in just the voices over a suitable picture? Should it be our presenters dressed for the part? But no. You see, both people are in situations that they never imagined that they would be. Could this be me? Could it be you? Listen now, and we will share, and then we will share in the song, "How Deep the Father's Love for Us."
Hello, my name's Peter. Yeah, that Peter. The one who said, "I'll follow you anywhere, Jesus." The one who was so full of himself when he recognised that Jesus was the Christ when nobody else seemed to. The one who was so proud when Jesus recognised him as a tower of strength and called him the Rock. The one who set out to fight off the soldiers when Jesus was arrested. The one who denied even knowing Jesus when trapped by that young serving girl in the courtyard. I'm that Peter. Not much to be proud of, is there? Unfortunately, I didn't understand how the mood of the crowd was changing once Jesus was in enemy hands, and I just didn't think how dangerous it would be for me to be in that place. It was only when that servant girl looked at me in that strange way and then asked me directly whether I was a friend of Jesus that I looked around and saw just how many hostile faces there were. So I panicked, didn't I? And I couldn't believe I was hearing myself denying that I knew Jesus. But once I'd said it, I couldn't go back. They seemed to ignore me for a bit after that, so I hung around. But then I must have said a few words to somebody about, I don't know, how cold it was, and they recognised my northern accent and started on me again. I was really frightened that time, and my tongue just got the better of me as usual, and I found myself cursing and swearing that I didn't know Jesus in any way. Then I heard the cock crow 3 times, and immediately I was back with the memory of Jesus telling me, only the night before, that I would deny him 3 times. I was devastated because suddenly Jesus was looking at me, and I knew that he knew what I'd done. Even if he hadn't actually heard the word I'd said, I didn't know what to do with myself, and I just wept and wept and wept, and then I ran away. I betrayed him, and I didn't know how to live with myself.
I knew he was one of them from the first minute I saw him. Sneaking through the gateway like that, keeping in the shadows, avoiding people, trying to cover his face. It was very easy to see who he was. You know, it was the night of that big so-called trial, when they dragged that carpenter in front of them and he caused such a scandal by claiming to be the Christ. This other man, he was terrified. You could see that in his face. That's why he kept to the shadows and he tried not to be noticed. It was a cold night, and he must have been frozen with fear as well, so he gradually started moving towards the fire to warm himself. It was just curiosity on my part, really. In a way, I felt sorry for him, because I'm sure his friend wasn't the dangerous rebel they were making him out to be. So I only went a bit closer to see if I was right about this stranger. At first, he didn't take too much notice of me, although he did turn away when I tried to look straight at him. So I moved round to where I could see him properly, and I said, "Weren't you with that Nazarene, that Jesus?" I didn't really mean any harm by it, but he turned on me as if I was accusing him of a crime, and he snapped back that he'd had nothing to do with him. Well, I wasn't out to cause trouble, so I left, and the man disappeared for a while. Went over to the gateway, I think. I was out there later myself, and I said something about him to the group that was standing around. You know, I'm sure that man was with that Jesus. He heard me, probably recognised that I'd said something to him before. And he turned on me again and said, "No!" much more forcibly this time. He probably knew that the others were curious now too. I walked away then. I hadn't really intended to get him into trouble, so I kept out of it. But word had spread, and one of the men went over to accuse him. "You're a Galilean. You must be a follower." Well, you should have heard the language. It was obvious he was from Galilee, and most likely a fisherman, judging by some of the words he used. He cursed and he swore. He was so angry and so afraid. "I don't even know this man you're talking about," he shouted, so loud that heads were beginning to turn, even away from the scene of the trial. And then the strangest thing happened. The rooster crowed, and the man stopped shouting and he stood stock still. You'd have thought he'd been struck dumb. I couldn't understand it. I mean, dawn was breaking, the rooster was crowing. That's nature for you. But there was something very significant about it for him. He seemed to be, at first, terrified, and then absolutely devastated. And without thinking, I turned to look at the prisoner. Jesus. He was looking straight at his friend, and there was such sadness in his eyes. You'd almost think that he was weeping. And then the man, the stranger, he took to his heels and ran with tears streaming down his face. I don't blame him for being afraid. I would have been afraid if I'd have been him in that crowd. But I don't think I'll ever forget the look that the prisoner gave him.
So, let's think about Peter and Jesus. For here we find example after example of patience and forgiveness. If we summarise what we have recognised about the character of Peter, what might we say? He was the one that gets noticed, and we find out that this was not always a good thing when the pressure was on. He wasn't afraid to ask questions if he thought he didn't understand, but he is headstrong and sometimes abrasive and misunderstanding what he sees, and he won't be corrected easily. We could say he's a bit of a show-off. If only he could carry through his confidence. And in the end, he just failed. He failed to recognise the warning from Jesus. He failed to stand up and be counted. He failed his master, with whom he had experienced so much. But throughout all this, Jesus is so patient with Peter. Jesus sees the potential in Peter, even with all his faults. You see, Jesus didn't look for perfection when he called his disciples to follow him. If we look at a map of Galilee, and you'll probably find one in the back of your Bible. If we look at a map of Galilee, the northern end of the Sea of Galilee is right out in the sticks, a long way from Jerusalem, about 80 miles or so. Jerusalem is where Jesus might have found priests, a rabbi, holy men. But he didn't want such people. He wanted those who would respond to his call to follow him, to trust him. He didn't want people with preconceived ideas or people embedded in procedure and in long-established custom. He wanted people who would answer to his call and to follow him. Jesus once asked his disciples as they were walking along, who do people say that I am? And the answers from the disciples typically were Elijah, Jeremiah, one of the prophets. And then he asked them, who do you say that I am? And Peter answered, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. We find that in the 16th chapter of Matthew at verse 16. And Jesus replies that Peter hasn't worked this out for himself, but that God, in the power of his Spirit, has revealed it to him. And because of this, Jesus is going to build his church with Peter, Peter the Rock. And Peter would be its foundation. And even with all this confidence in Peter, at the end, in Jerusalem, Peter fails big style, as we've recognised earlier. But God's limitless love is demonstrated again. After the resurrection, Jesus speaks to Peter. He reverts back to his name, Simon. And he asks him three times, do you love me? Of course, says Peter. Peter says this three times, and he is forgiven by the risen Jesus. So what about Peter, Jesus, and us? Lent is a time of personal preparation, often marked by giving up something, perhaps a regular treat. Lent is a time of study and reflection on the life and the death and the sacrifice of Jesus on the cross. Lent is a time for doing something extra, for study, for supporting those in need, for stepping outside our comfort zone in faith, knowing that we have the love and the patience shown to us in Jesus and the forgiveness for when we go wrong, just as he did to Peter. So if we trust in Jesus, he gives us the confidence to try again. Why? Well, that's how he was. That's how he is. We can see in the life of Peter a range of mistakes that he made, and yet he was still loved. His potential was still recognised. You are Peter, the rock, upon which I will build my church, said Jesus. It would now be easy to say to you and to myself, go out into the world confidently, taking with you the assurance that you are loved, even with your faults, and go and do God's work. But pause for a moment. What do you think will be God's plan for you this week? We are limited, aren't we? We can't visit, We can go for a walk, one to one, providing we don't take a flask and sit down and enjoy it. It's got to be exercise. Yes, we can go for a walk. We might buy flowers or a gift. Let me make a suggestion. First, pray about what you are going to do and ask God to guide you. So let's take an example and say that we're going to phone someone to check on them. Who will it be? Now, don't choose the easy one. Decide on someone who may be a challenge to you. Think and pray of them by name. And now, think about how that may go. You might have to be patient. You will want to show love. If they tell you how much they appreciate your call, how will you feel? Will you feel good about that? Will you be humble about what you have done? So go, make the call, and when you ring, pause. How did it go? How did you feel? Next time, what would you do differently? And no matter how it went, thank God, because his love and power was there for you and for your friend. That is his promise. And so we come to pray together. We use a Lenten prayer based on Psalm 121, a prayer that comes from All We Can, the Methodist and Relief and Development Organisation. So let us pray. I lift up my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from? Loving God, we look to you this Lent for help, for hope, for reassurance that you are dwelling with us. And together we lift up our voices to declare, my help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. Let's say that together. My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. God, our refuge and strength, we cry out for your protection for our frontline workers and for those who are most vulnerable at this time. We thank you for the development and the distribution of the vaccine and the joy that this brings us. We pray for our brothers and sisters in marginalised communities who are less certain of when a vaccine will be available to them. And we pray that those of us who have the opportunity to have surplus supplies of vaccine may be moved to share them quickly with those who struggle to get them. May there be equity and accessibility for all. And again, we raise our voices to declare, my help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. Lord of all, this Lent we open our hearts and minds, asking that you will fill them with the knowledge of your love. And we lift our voices to declare, my help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and going, both now and forevermore. God of restoration, We pray for all those who are sick and in need of healing. Bring wholeness and well-being, we ask, that you comfort the grieving, the lonely, the lost, and the uncertain. And we lift our voices to declare, my help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. Amen. And we say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And so we come to our closing hymn, and it has the words, from the old I travel to the new, keep me travelling along with you. We sing from Singing the Faith 476, one more step along the world I go.
Step along the world I go. One more step along the world I go. From the old things to the new, just keep me traveling along with you. Round the corners of the world I turn, more and more about the world I learn, and the new things that I see, you'll be looking at along with me. And it's from the old I travel to the new, just keep me traveling along with you. Give me courage when the world is rough, keep me loving though this world is tough. Leap and sing in all I do, just keep me traveling along with you. And it's from the old I travel to the new, just keep me traveling along with you. And the life in me, ever old and ever new, just keep me traveling along with you. And it's from the old I travel to the new, just keep me traveling along with you. Just keep me traveling along.
And so, thanks to Ian and Jill and Marjorie, thanks to Roz, and thanks to Ashley, who stitches all this together. And we share with you, share with me in the grace. the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. Thank you for joining us. Keep safe, and the Lord be with you always. Amen.
Everything of this world will fade. I'm pressing on till I see.